Pellegrini, who is a professor in nutrition at the University of Udine, and who also holds a position at the University of Wageningen in the Netherlands, who will talk to us about sustainable food between reality and false myths.
Thank you. Good morning. Thank you for a kind presentation and for inviting me to this conference. So sustainable food should be part of a sustainable diet. So I will start with the official definition of sustainable diets that are diets with a low environmental impact, which contribute to food and nutrition security and to healthy life for present and future generation. Sustainable diets are protective, respectful of biodiversity and ecosystem, culturally acceptable, accessible, economically fair and affordable, nutritionally adequate, safe and healthy, while optimizing natural and human resources. So there are three elements in the definition of these diets that are healthy aspects, environmental impact, and socio-economical, socio-cultural aspects. So a diet, okay, I need to move because I cannot read, sorry, in the screen. So regarding the healthy aspects, those diets are based on great variety of unprocessed and minimal processed foods, balance across food group. The diets includes whole grain, legumes, nuts, and fruits and vegetables. Can also include a moderate amount of eggs, dairy, poultry, and fish, and small amount of red meat. Of course, should be consistent with the WHO guidelines to reduce the risk of diet-related and non-communicable diseases. Exactly what should be in a sustainable healthy diet was defined in the Int'l Commission 2019. They defined the global scientific targets for shifting the world toward healthy diets and sustainable food production with the idea to feed the expected 10 billion of population. The proposition of the commission was that current dietary trends are not feasible to feed the expected growing population. On one hand, the global border of communicable disease is getting worse and worse. And on the other hand, the footprint effect of the current food production is reducing the stability of the earth system. Therefore, a great food transformation is needed. So the commission established the gram per day of each whole food group, meaning whole grain, vegetable, fruit, tubers, and so on, based on the environmental impact of food production combined with nutrition requirement for children older than 2 years and adults. So when the diet reference diet should be adopted, is expected that a reduction of premature mortality and the possibility to avoid about 11.1 million deaths per year in 2030. So according to the commission, this pattern should be flexible. within a safe, so in a within a safe operating space, can feed the population tailored food to the preferences and cultures of different population. For this reason, is called also the planetary diet, and since it can be adapted to different culture and different dietary pattern, while maintaining the healthiness and environmental sustainability. However, we are far from this reference dietary intake, especially in terms of high introduction of red meat, starchy vegetable, eggs, but lower introduction of plant-based foods such as vegetable, fruit, legumes, and so on. So based on that comparison, even if the planetary diet is not a vegetarian diet, it's clear that we should move to a more plant-based diet. However, not all the diets, plant-based diets, are equally sustainable. So it is important to define which dietary pattern is sustainable, but also healthy, of course, to support consumers in making sustainable choices. So in this study, they studied the environmental healthy and animal welfare impact of different common plant-based diets. And they found that higher the score, higher the sustainability, that vegan diet is more sustainable in terms of gas emission, land use, but not in terms of water use, even when compared to the omnivore's diet. In the case of healthy impact, Mediterranean diet was the best, and combining the results from a questionnaire used to measure the probability of adopting a new diet in a group of Australian adults, the Mediterranean diet was shown to have the greatest projected positive impact, followed by the vegetarian diet. So based on these results, we can say that a small quantity of animal product would be a good compromise between health and sustainability. That the vegan diet is not as sustainable as expected, and not significant different from the sustainability of vegetarian diet, was emerged also in our study, in which we use the recorded dietary intake of a group of population instead than the ideal or hypothetical diet that usually are used. We speculate that the effect of that was due to probably several aspects. One is that in hypothetical vegetarian vegan diets, usually unprocessed plant-based foods replace animal-based foods. However, in the real diet, people use a lot of industrial, highly processed plant-based meat and dairy substitute. Moreover, the lower density, energy density of plant-based foods results, of course, in a higher food intake for vegan with respect to the vegetarian. So therefore, a higher impact, especially in terms of water consumption. So these consideration allow me to highlight three aspects that are for me central when you define a healthy diet and healthy sustainable diet. The question are plant-based foods substitute always more sustainable than animal products? Are plant-based substitute as nutritious as animal food they replace? And which functional unit should be used to evaluate the environmental impact of food? So I will go over this aspect with you in the next slides. So meat alternatives can be produced using different protein sources, for example, gluten, soy, but also insect, mycoproteins, and so on. In this study, the authors evaluate the life cycle calculated from the cradle to the plate of several meat substitute compared to a fried chicken that is considered the most environmental friendly meat. As you can see, some lab-grown alternative meat produce a lot had a very high impact, but in the case of gluten and other plant-based foods, the difference with the impact of chicken was not as big as expected, probably due to the energy that is consumed during the extraction of protein from their sources. In this study, they calculate the life cycle stages from cradle to gate, in this case retail, of two alternative milk and a regular one. They use two functional units. One was the liter of milk, and the results are reported. So more or less in all the aspect that regular milk performed the worst except in case the global warming and in case of water intake. But when we considered the kilogram of protein in the milk that they provide, the picture changed completely. In this case, the almond milk performed the worst with respect to other milks. So why use this unit? Because milk is, of course, a source of protein in our diet. So it is important that milk substitute provide at least the same nutrient than the food they replaced. And this brings to the second question. Unfortunately, the reply is no. And this is clear when we have a look at the title of this study. So the authors proposed that it's time to define the nutrient standards for these beverages, plant-based beverages, because in general, the nutrition quality is very low. So they focus especially on quantity of protein, quality of protein, and also they suggested that a serving of this milk should contain at least the 50% of nutrient requirement, daily nutrient requirement of at least calcium, vitamin D, vitamin B12. They analyze also commercial plant-based beverages present in the USDA database, and following their standard nutrient standard, they just this large amount of beverages in only 5% of them met the nutrient standard. So based on what I already said, the critical point in defining the sustainable food is for sure the functional unit. You can have a different approach, for example, in case of milk protein, kilo quantity of protein, or as Int'l Lancet Commission use, serving of food. And they, in fact, evaluate the environmental effect of this of each food group based on the serving of food. However, we don't eat all food in the same quantity and the same frequency, especially. And this should be clear. Considered, for example, this graphic representation of a sustainable Mediterranean diet. Of course, cereals, vegetables, fruit are consumed in large portion every meal, should be consumed at least in large portion every meal. This means a large quantity of these foods. On the contrary, animal protein sources should be consumed in smaller portion on the weekly basis. So bring to a smaller quantity and therefore a smaller impact than when we calculated on the basis of, for example, kilo or liter of food. So there are several aspects that could be considered when we try to define a sustainable food and a sustainable diet. For example, a colleague in Milan defined an Italian Mediterranean dietary pattern based on the Int'l Lancet reference diet. And also they evaluated the carbon footprint changes when in that diet gradually we substitute food with the other food. In this case, in this graph, for example, fresh food with the frozen vegetables, local fruit with imported fruits, or seasonal vegetables with greenhouse grown vegetables. As you can see, the way the food is produced, the vegetables is produced, has the big impact on the diet. So how to conclude this difficult and complex topic? I would say that it is tricky to push consumer toward a more plant-based diet without accepting the fact that they will continue to consume a more convenient, ready-to-eat plant-based foods. So we need to find a way to reduce the environmental impact of this food, but on the other hand, these foods should be made healthier, for example, fortifying them with vitamin B12 that is present only in animal sources. That of course needs to be extracted or synthesized, so using additional resources. That could generate further doubt of the sustainability. So the path toward a sustainable diet is still long and unfortunately full of challenges. And thank you for the attention.
Thanks a lot, Nicoletta. We have time for questions. One from the floor.
Thank you very much for a wonderful presentation. I'm not an expert in this, and therefore I want to ask you. A lot of vegans eat raw food. And what is the bioavailability of all these micronutrients from raw food when compared to cooked food? Could you please answer if they also lack all these micronutrients? Mm-hmm.
Mm. Thank you for the question. In terms of soluble vitamin, it's better, of course, to eat raw food. But the digestibility and the bioavailability, for example, of proteins or liposoluble compounds is lower when you consume the raw foods, so than the cooked food. Okay. Okay, so in general, it depends on the type of cooking methods and so on, but not always. I would say that not always the raw food are better than cooked food.
So it means that we have a balance before and
exactly.
There are so many books that say, okay, it's better to consume raw. But
therefore I needed your opinion for that. And also regarding meat-based and fish-based products, do you think it's more healthy to eat raw, like sashimi, than cooked fish, for example? Even if light cooked, then you have more availability of bioavailability of proteins, or it's also the same as with vegetarian food?
Vegetarian?
Is complex question because for me vegetarian depends on the food, so it's complicated because every food has the own cooking method. Mm-hmm. Of course, different cooking method, but the best in terms of to increase the bioavailability and so on. For example, we say that cooked meat usually are more release more proteins.
Okay.
But sometimes, if the temperature is too high, for example, when you roasted or so on, produce a cross linking between the proteins, and this reduce the digestibility.
And also my question was, when you cook meat or fish, then you aggregate the proteins, and then for enzymes to cleave them, that was my point. So do we reduce bioavailability or not so much if it's light cooking, for example?
Light cooking in this case is better than raw.
Okay, exactly. Thank you.
Welcome.
We have to connect with the Philippines. So I think we'll leave the questions for after. I just have a quick one for you. In terms of the adherence to the Eat Lancet diet, one of the most striking things is that, especially in Europe and North America, we are eating too much meat. Mm-hmm. What are the greatest obstacles to changing that situation? Are these consumer habits, or are these resistances from the animal farming system, or is it both?
Both, probably. Yeah. Also both. I would say both. And the study I presented was related to also which diet could be adopted. And of course, it's not a vegan diet because it's too extreme for omnivores people, but probably Mediterranean or a diet in which you could reduce the quantity of meat could be a good option.
Thank you. We'll have time for questions at the end of the next presentation, also for Nicoletta, who will be here. And our next speaker is